over ICE and illegal immigration. It burst into new levels of intensity and, you might say, insanity over the July 4th holiday, with Democrat-backed protests taking place across the country on Independence Day. I don't know about you, but when I think Independence Day, I think protesting law enforcement. And we shouldn't be surprised after abolish ICE has become the new rallying cry for many, and not just the hard left, but just the straight up left. Listen.
I think that this disastrous immigration policy should be abolished. I happen to have voted against ICE, the formation of ICE, back in 2002.
I'm for the abolition of ICE.
Congress needs to change the policies of ICE so they don't terrorize communities.
And now those on the ground have reportedly, or no, apparently, not just apparently, they have resorted to stunt tactics. One protester climbed New York's Statue of Liberty yesterday to wave the Abolish ICE banner, leading to the evacuation of Liberty Island. And of course, plenty of American citizens and others didn't get access to Lady Liberty yesterday. After hours, the protester was finally pulled down and arrested, rightfully so, by law enforcement, but she could barely wait to speak out to the public following her release. Listen.
Michelle Obama, our beloved first lady that I care so much about, said, when they go low, we go high, and I went as high as I could.
Yeah, risking the lives of law enforcement in the process. But naturally, President Trump was game to take her on tonight in his Montana rally. Listen.
You saw that clown yesterday on the Statue of Liberty? You see the guys that went up there? I wouldn't have done it. I would have said, let's get some nets and let's wait till she comes down. Just get some nets. Really, yeah. You see those guys, the bravery of doing that? What a group.
Clown is right. The president also fired a new shot over the bow of his immigration critics.
The new platform of the Democrat Party is to abolish ICE. In other words, they want to abolish immigration enforcement entirely. That's what they want to do. They want everybody coming in. And you know, the beauty with ICE, they're so tough. When you have these MS-13 thugs come in, ICE goes in and wipes them out like nothing, because they're much tougher. We will not stand for these vile Democrat smears against our law enforcement.
Strong stuff. Well, joining us now with reaction tonight from Irvine, California, former ICE agent Claude Arnold. We've got immigration attorney Alan Orr joins us live from Washington, D.C. And with us in studio, former INS Special Agent Michael Cutler. Thank you, gentlemen, all for joining us this morning. Michael, I'll start with you here, right here in studio. You were with the INS, which is the precursor to ICE. After 9/11, ICE was formed. But yet you say even this iteration after 9/11 of ICE is not enough.
No, it's not. We've got about 6,000 ICE agents for the entire country. More than half of them aren't even doing immigration enforcement. The 9/11 commission to which I provided.
6,000. And only half, or so 3,000,
if we're lucky,
loyal ICE agents enforcing the law.
Immigration laws from within the interior. And if you look at the 9/11 commission report, and I provided testimony to the commission, multiple failures of the immigration system, particularly a lack of meaningful interior enforcement, immigration fraud, visa fraud, made it possible for the terrorists, not only on 9/11, but they looked at other terrorists. And almost all of them exploited vulnerabilities in the immigration system. So now we've got 3,000 ICE agents enforcing immigration law versus 20,000 Border Patrol agents, 45,000 TSA employees, and 37,000 police officers just for the city of New York. ICE is almost non-existent anyway. So why in the world would you get rid of it?
Once they get through, they're outmatched as far as size and number of agents at this point.
And it's not just about arresting illegal aliens. It's about going after the fraud. It's about going after employers who hire these folks. It's about going after the gangs and working on
drugs,
the task
human
forces.
And everything like that. Sure. Claude, let me go to you. As an ICE agent who's been on the ground, are there enough of you? I know you're retired, but what do the folks still there believe and feel?
Yeah, well, so as a point of correction, I too was with the INS before ICE was created. But as a point of correction, the Enforcement and Removal Operations Division has about 6,000 officers and agents itself, and all they do is civil immigration enforcement, the interior enforcement. Then Homeland Security Investigation, the special agents, half of their duties is immigration enforcement. They have 6,000 agents. So if you want to say half their time is spent doing investigating immigration crimes, then I guess you could say 3,000 of them are
fair point. But 3,000 or 6,000, still not a lot compared to other agencies as well. But talk to me about your work on the ground every day. You're accused of being a terrorist. You're accused of being a thug. Yeah. You're accused of being inhumane. Talk to me about the job of an ICE agent.
Yeah, that's obviously is ludicrous, because ICE was born out of 9/11, and one of its primary responsibilities is counterterrorism and national security. They have the second largest presence on the Federal Joint Terrorism Task Force of any other federal agency. They not only investigate immigration crimes related to national security threats, but they also investigate customs violations related to the same thing. So export violation, export of technology that are going to bad actor countries like North Korea, potentially China. And then, of course, the immigration enforcement stuff, you know, disrupting and dismantling the organizations that smuggle people, goods into the U.S. that threaten our national
security. Well, groups like MS-13 that the president has talked about quite a bit. Alan, let me go to you. You're an immigration attorney. You probably take a bit of a different view on this. You've talked, at least in what I've read, about structural reforms to ICE as opposed to abolish ICE. But the rhetoric on the left is abolish. What's the difference in your mind?
There's a huge difference. I mean, I think the show guests tonight really show the issue that I want to put forward. Before there was ICE, there was INS, and INS doesn't exist anymore, and now ICE does exist, and we still protect our borders. So this conversation about abolish ICE really is a little bit of a political fringe on both ends of the parties. So if we sort of think about this for a minute, it's not about a political conversation
right now.
What's
the political fringe on the right, Alan? I don't mean to interrupt you, but what's the political fringe on the right when you refer?
Libertarians are also saying, what is ICE's purpose? What is the purpose of ICE? So on both ends of the spectrum,
they're not climbing the Statue of Liberty. I mean, they're not putting their whole platform as a party on abolishing ICE.
And neither are we. We're putting our platform on human rights and humanitarian rights, because in your montage, what was missing were the women separated from their children and this delay of 3,000 kids, or maybe more, that we don't know about. So this conversation about ICE really isn't so much about ICE, but really about this humanitarian problem we have at our border, and this blown out consideration of saying, oh, ICE isn't doing enough, when in fact your first guest said CBP really is at the border. There are enough people there. We have officers in New York City. Well, so what is this great concern? Well, what is ICE really doing?
Good. It's a fair point. You talked about Alan, about securing the border. Michael, you know, I know INS and ICE are internal enforcement, but if you had the border secured, then the need for ICE wouldn't
be what
it is today.
Where does the border exist? We have 50 border states. The notion that everything happens on the Mexican border is wrong. None of the 9/11 hijackers ran the Mexican border. Go back to the 9/11 report. We have 50 border states. Any state that lies on the northern or southern borders or has international airports or has access to our 95,000 miles of coastline are border states.
You have a little bit of agreement with Alan, though. You're saying you don't think ICE is structured properly right now. But your argument is ICE isn't ICE enough, that there isn't enough latitude.
Well, I'll tell you who would agree with that also is the former chairman of the House Immigration Subcommittee, a Republican by the name of John Hostetler. I was at a hearing with him 44 months after 9/11. He complained that the way DHS was put together de-emphasized border security and immigration enforcement. And it's remarkable, because 44 months after 9/11, that's how long it took us to win the Second World War. At that hearing, we were told that they were still working on a mission statement for immigration.
Exactly. Even today. I mean, I think part of the issue that we should look at is that they really haven't have a clear mission. As your guest said, they're doing this and this and this and this and this. So
then,
what
is
that really clear mission that they need to be doing?
Is the answer to abolish, or is the answer to refine, or refine down to the core mission of the fact that we don't have our arms around who's coming to our country? The president has made the point about merit-based immigration. We don't have that right now. So until we do, wouldn't we want ICE out there aggressively enforcing our laws?
Listen, we all want our laws.
If I could jump in here.
Yeah, sure. We are a country of laws.
We'll get you one second. Enforced. Absolutely.
And I think part of the problem here is the characterization of the issue. People applying for asylum at the southern ports is not illegal immigration, because they have a right to apply for asylum.
Well, what's
the numbers
wrong,
are not the problem.
What's wrong with arresting the folks that
people
don't go
that
to port of entry?
Ports of entries every day and don't have an issue with them at other ports.
I have to make one point about
that.
Hold
on, let me get to Claude. Right. Claude first, as a former ICE agent, please.
Yeah, so it's absolutely right. ICE is essential. And they are not used to their full effectiveness. You know, both on the left and the right, there has been an ignorance of interior enforcement. So yes. When they passed the Immigration Reform and Control Act of 1986, the idea was, okay, give amnesty to the people, and now we're going to secure the borders, and we're going to do interior enforcement. We're going to make sure that only people who are authorized to work can work. But, you know, as long as the border is not secure, the magnet for people to come here is employment.
Michael, before I get to enforcing that... Yeah, absolutely. What's the morale of an agent on the ground right now who hears the impugning of their motives that they're horrible people? Does it affect the way they do their job?
I think they're used to it. I mean, when you do this, you know, Mr. Cutler can attest to this. It's very political. You know, as the political winds shift, we just adjust. We're very resilient. And so those agents are very resilient. Immigration enforcement is a politically charged topic, and they know, depending on who's in the White House, who's in the Congress, the political winds will change.
Michael, but I know when I was in the military, the last thing I wanted was politics infecting my ability to do my job.
But it does. But here's what's being left out of interior enforcement. It's not just making arrests. It's going after immigration fraud. Goodness, we've given citizenship
visa
to
overstays.
Terrorists.
Yeah.
Not only overstays. The Tsarnaev family got political asylum, claiming credible fear, we can't go home. They went home as soon as they got asylum. One of the brothers was a naturalized citizen. Faisal Shahzad, the Times Square bomber, mm-hmm. naturalized citizen. We are processing applications for citizenship, giving the keys to the kingdom to aliens without doing the investigations that are necessary to properly vet
them. It does not strike me as a good idea, Alan.
That's a problem.
You talked about ports of entry.
Yeah.
Why wouldn't the emphasis just be, if you're coming here seeking asylum, you have a legitimate issue, go to a port of entry. But as the president has pointed out, if you're going to sprint across that border knowing what you're doing is illegal, why are you given and afforded all the rights of a citizen?
I don't think that they're sprinting across the border, as we're always claimed. There's a little bit of zero tolerance about people who enter between ports of entry. People are coming here to file for asylum, which is a natural American law. And I think if we did revamp the immigration system so that it did work for the people that are here who are undocumented or people who needed to be here to work, as we've already seen an increase in H-2B visas to meet the need of the markets, then we wouldn't have this problem.
No.
So it's about sort of reforming the system and making it work, sort of backlogging immigration more than it already is, the 6,000 cases that we have, or asylum that are waiting in the courts, and the huge backlogs in Indian national and Chinese nationals waiting for legal immigration processes is not the answer. Sort of shutting down the United States and saying everybody needs to have this extreme vetting. What is extreme vetting necessarily? I'm waiting on that memorandum to see what it is.
I'll tell you what
Michael,
it is.
10 seconds.
Okay.
Briefly.
It's doing investigations in the field to determine who's actually in the country. By the way, we keep displacing American workers with foreign workers. It drives down wages. Because immigration has become a delivery system for an unlimited supply of cheap labor and immigration clients for members of Congress who happen to be immigration attorneys also.
Well, and at the very least, we want to know who's coming here. We want them having the skills
and not displace American workers and not pose a threat to our safety.
Unemployment's at the lowest rate possible, right? Unemployment is the lowest rate possible.
We're going to leave it right there. I appreciate that. I'll tell you this.
You have to know who you're letting in the country.
Of course.
Absolutely. If you're saying you didn't know that before now, I mean, do you honestly believe that we're letting in thousands of people a day without knowing who they are?
One thing, as you have said, Alan, that
if you grant amnesty to a bunch of people,
we've got to leave it right there, gentlemen.
Absolutely doing
that. Thank you for your service. All of you appreciate it.
Thank you.